So welcome to you all, and thank you for coming. A special thanks to people here and not here, I won't name them by name, who helped to make this event possible, because as you can imagine, this isn't something that happens just like that. We're here to remember Anapurna Turkhud, a woman who meant a great deal to Rabindranath Tagore at a certain point in his life. Difficult to know exactly what happened when they met in Bombay in the 1880s, but she was, or the 1870s, she was very important to him when he stayed with her parents. We're here to bring Anna's life to the attention of the people of Edinburgh, because she came and died here in Marchmont, tragically early, 132 years ago today, hence the date we've chosen. Now, a poet in ancient times once wrote, and I'm sure many of you are familiar with this, that to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. But there's also a time to mourn and a time to dance. And the poet might have added, a time to forget and a time to remember. And Anna's life has been really somewhat forgotten. So what we're here today to do is to remember it in different ways. We're not planning to dance, but you can if you like. We are planning to remember Anna with some singing and some music. You've heard some of the music from Scotland, and we'll have some music from Bengal as well. So my name is Roger Jeffrey. I've introduced myself to most of you in the course of the last 10 minutes or so, those I don't already know. And I'm here because for the past 7 or 8 years, I've been part of a project to understand better the relationship between India in its broadest sense and Edinburgh as the city. I used to call this project, in my own mind at least, Edinburgh, an Indian city? Question mark. And you can understand that was a bit over the top, but it gives you an idea, a general idea of what I was trying to do and what people, Bashabi and Hapka, you'll hear from in a few minutes, as part of this project have been trying to do, is to make clear the links that exist between Edinburgh and India, not only contemporary, but also in the past, and to make them visible, not just to a casual visitor, but also to residents of Edinburgh. It's very difficult to see the links between India and Edinburgh in the streets. There are very few places where India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, whatever it is you want to call that part of South Asia that's linked, very few places where those names stand out. But a little bit of digging shows a lot of context and a lot of contacts between the city and the subcontinent. And here's one that was absolutely forgotten. So that is why we're here. So my understanding is that we're here because Anapurna's story is a part of that larger story. It's a part of a step in a journey to rectify this invisibility of the links between Edinburgh and India. Now, those of us who made it a business of ours to create the plaque and to establish where it should go and put it up, as you can see behind me, cannot argue that we cannot fully understand Edinburgh as a city without understanding its history, and its history has to include India. For two centuries, between the 1750s and the 1950s, India was hardly ever off the pages of the Scotsman or the other Indian Edinburgh newspapers. There was always something that linked Edinburgh and India together. But in the last 70 or 80 years, that context, that contact has become much less visible. Anapurna came here in 1891. As far as we know, certainly she came to be with her brother, who was studying medicine. And indeed, he was like many other young Indian men who came to Edinburgh to study, often, but not only medicine. And we've been trying to find their studies, their stories. But there are also Indian women who did the same thing. Now, Bashabi and Hapka have contributed a great deal over the past few years to unraveling the story of Anapurna, her brother, her family, and why she was here and what happened to her. And they'll talk about that in a few minutes. And there will also be opportunities at the end for anybody else here who wants to say something about what Anna's story means to them, whatever that might be. But before I hand over to Hauke to say part of the story in his words, I want just to say something about Anna's direct descendants. An event like this would normally have people here, would be run by the family, for the family, and they would be a central part of what we're doing. On this occasion, and the Anna's direct descendants that we know about live in, I think, in Connecticut. And so even though I gave them a couple of weeks' warning, unfortunately, they weren't able just to turn up and come. But they are with us in spirit. And here's what Cynthia Curtis, who is one of the family of the descendants, wrote to me, and I got the email this morning. She said, "My former father-in-law, Harold Aylmer Littledale Jr., was a learned, cultured, and accomplished man. He was also extraordinarily family-centered, and it was from him that I learnt about the Littledale family's ancestry. I believe he recognized in me the same strong sense of family and knew that in sharing stories and information about his father, Harold Sr., his grandparents, Harold and Anna, as well as previous generations in Little Wales, that I would ensure these would be kept alive and passed on to his grandchildren and future generations. Receiving Anna's necklace upon my marriage to his son Krishna was beyond meaningful for me. Though Anna was not my own ancestor, I felt and still do feel a real and true connection to her. I was proud to be the necklace's caretaker and wore it often, sharing what little, as it turns out, I knew of Anna's story with many people during the years of our marriage. On behalf of my stepson, William Littledale, my daughter, Alexa Littledale Curtis, and myself, please know we are grateful to the dedicated researchers who uncovered and brought so vividly to life so many heretofore unknown and fascinating details about Anna, her family, her life, and even her death. I am including a photo of Alexa, who is, at Harold Jr.'s request, the next proud and privileged guardian of Anna's necklace and her story. And we have a photograph of the necklace, which is on the table over there. So I'm now going to hand over to Hauke, who carried out most of the primary research that established the Edinburgh end of Anna's life.
Thank you very much for joining us here today. When Anapurna Turkhud Littledale died on this day, the 2nd July, 1891, she was 33 years of age. In those 33 years, she had taken many a bold step forward and taken many an unexpected turn in her life. She was born in Bombay in 1858 to a very progressive, reform-minded family dedicated to public service as doctors and scientists. It was the house of her father, Atmaram Pandurang Turkhud Littledale. She grew up in a very open house, where people and ideas walked in and out, mingled without prejudice, where the world was to be explored and to be actively stepped into. Anna, as well as her brothers, and as well as all her sisters, went abroad for studies, to make experiences, to gain knowledge, to bring back to their own country, to improve society, and do things like fighting deadly diseases. Anna herself brought back from her schooling abroad a lively talent for the melody of words in many languages. And that talent, she was asked as an English tutor to impart to young 70-year-old shy Bengali student Rabindranath Tagore, who was about to step out into the world, a world that he traveled a lot in his life and that he felt comfortable in more than most other Indians of his day. By all accounts, the two took to each other, teasing, playing, exploring each other's minds in poetry. And so the idea of Nalini, the poetic muse, formed in Tagore's mind in the person of Anna. And she would remain with him like that for many years as a lively spirit in his writing for many, many years afterwards. Although it must be said, he did defy her by growing his trademark beard, which she'd expressly forbidden him to do. Their time together was short, and Tagore went on to England and worldwide fame. Anna, meanwhile, 2 years later in 1880, married a young academic, Harold Littledale, passing through her always welcoming family, whose life work would be the educational reform for all primary school children in the state of Baroda, which was quite revolutionary at the time. With him together in Baroda, she brought up into early childhood, into middle childhood, three children, two daughters and a son, Anna Nalini, born in 1880, Olga, born in 1884, and Harold Aylmer, who's already been mentioned here, in 1885. It was a while after her marriage that she decided in 1882 to convert to Christianity. This much we know from the Tagore biographies of Prashanta Kumar Pal and Prabhat Kumar Mukhopadhyay. There's a family, Littledale family memory of them all going to live in Britain at the end, and she not taking to life in Britain and then leaving, but no great amount of detail is available on that, I'm afraid. The next we hear of her reliably is that she's here in Edinburgh at 12 Warrender Park Crescent in Marchmont. Her brother, Nyaneshwar, a 29-year-old medical student, is attending her on the 26th of June, 1891, at the birth of her second son, Denzil Fane Sewell. The father, who was also present in Edinburgh at the time and registered the birth, is Henry Fane Dalrymple Sewell, a 29-year-old bank clerk with ambitions in poetry from an influential London family with many Indian colonial and possibly some say also illegitimate royal connections. But then tragedy struck, and after 6 days of septicemia and nervous exhaustion, Anna dies at 12:40 p.m. on the 2nd of July, 1891. The baby Denzil, now motherless, is given to a nurse in Broughty Ferry in Dundee, where he also dies, sadly, exactly 4 months after his mother, on the 2nd of November in 1891. The father, Henry, left shortly afterwards for North America and eventually a new family life and moderate fame as an Edwardian patriotic poet in Vancouver, Canada. Anna and her little Denzil, the grave here in Morningside, had long lost any markers it might have had, and so it was long unknown to us. It is only thanks to the research of Caroline Gerard that it could be identified. And now, thanks to the determination of Professor Roger Jeffrey, a memorial can finally be unveiled here by us all today. We've talked a lot about her, or rather we've talked a lot about her in the light, often very bright, of the men that knew her. Some only very briefly, her father Atmaram, her friend Rabindranath Tagore, her husband Harold, her brother, the father of her last child, Henry. I have a feeling, though, that from what we can tell, she was very much her own person. We know of her that all her siblings, as did her parents and her uncles, all made great steps onwards from their society's orthodoxy. She admired that. We know that of her, because even as a young girl, she made a point of recording her visit to the grave in Bristol of the great reformer Raja Ram Mohan Roy. She married a foreigner when that was quite unusual. She already had a daughter before she was married. She changed her religion. Her family probably knew that she was an original mind. We know, though, that they did not disown her for any of the decisions that she made, because her brother stood by her in her need, as she had expected him to do. We know that after her death, her husband Harold is said to have forgiven her, and that soon after her death, on the Indian side of her family, a niece was named Nalini, and becoming an activist, an early actress, film actress, and a novelist, she seems to have lived out many of the dreams that the aunt she admired tragically could not make real anymore. So much we know, or things that we know of her, and so much we don't know. What happened to her writing, her poetry? Was it ever published? What drove her to leave her family? Where would she have gone with her life? Her husband, left behind, is said to have marked her grave with a simple stone. She loved much, it is said to have read. That has long been lost in those eventful 132 years since her death on this day. But that love and the abundance of life in her still shine through to us today. And so may this plaque reach back into the past, back to her days, to let her know that we are all here today for her, and that we still know her. Thank you very much.
I'm not going to add too much because you already have quite a lot from Roger and Halke, but it's been marvelous working with Roger and Halke, who saw the gravity of a story that needed to be recovered. For me as a woman, someone dying at 33, a mother of four children, and yet of diseases that we now know are preventable. The poet whose lines we still have to recover, but today that working with a lot of people, including Caroline, I don't think Caroline is here today. It's wonderful to have her commemorated, and it's great to have all of you here. And I hope this establishes one more link in a long chain of Indian and Scottish shared history. And long may it continue in this positive manner. 2 days ago, I had a phone call from India, and the man who rang me said he was the direct descendant from the same family where Anna came from, Dr. Atmaram Panduran Tilkarekar. I'm not pronouncing it properly, but we have Marathis here who can correct me and correct all of us. This is an anglicized spelling of the name. And he said that his grandfather was named Shatendranath, who was Tagore's older brother, who was a friend of Dr. Atmaram. Their brothers were named Jyotirindranath after Rabindranath's fifth brother, and Rabindranath after Rabindranath himself. The man who contacted me has a Bengali name, as all of them do in the family. Though they are Marathis, they were so close to the Tagore family that all their names are Bengali names, or rather popularly Bengali, they're Indian names. So he is called Shomuresh. His son is called Shukti, which is like Shotendrana, a shorter form. And his daughter is Anushka, and they call her Anna. So that Anna is never forgotten. You already have the story of Anna as we know it. I am going to refer to the women in her family, not the brothers. And this is a commemoration poem with seven-line stanzas about Anna Rabindranath's Nalini. I must say that Nalini was a name that Tagore loved. It means lotus, it means nectar, so the word is Amrit. And he actually used it in some poems he wrote before he came to Bombay, when he was in Shahi Bagh in his ICS brother, Shatindranath's house. Shatindranath was the first ICS. And I think all of you, if you haven't, you should be reading Alan Riet's article, who's here today, in the National on Monday, and you'll learn a lot from there. So here's the poem. When Anna asked Rabindranath to give her a name, he instantly gave her the name Nalini, which he had been using in his poems. So now he had somebody who could become his muse, not a mythical figure, but a real one. He was Rabindranath's Laura. And when Rabindranath married Bhavatarini, he instantly changed her name, and her name is Mrinalini. And that's food for thought. Mrinalini, Mrinalini. Nalini lives in Mrinalini, in Tagore's poetry, in Tagore's songs. Anna Rabindranath's Nalini. She was the second of three accomplished lassies in a family that had hailed the fierce sparks borne by the wild west wind that swept all that was moribund before it, carrying missives from far and near of change and hope that would restore an old and proud nation's dignity. He was the youngest of 14, walled in by a capacious house, enthralled by his gifted older siblings, restless to know the world beyond the massive gates, where the Hooghly flowed free, wafted to his poet's soul in a breeze breathing liberty. She sailed across the stage of his vision, an embodiment of elegance, magically conversant in many tongues that mingled the essence of the East and West in her expressive vitality. He was overawed by her beauty and confidence, her sophistication and gentle acceptance of his tongue-tied presence, broken by his eloquent verse. Yet she knew her responsibility as his youthful tutor, encouraging, gracious, and warm, urging him to shed his inherent shyness and embrace a friendship that could flower, if allowed, dissolving Marathi, Bengali singularity beyond the boundaries of time and space. In her, he discovered the incarnation of Petrarch's Laura, his favorite Nalini, a name plucked from his earlier verse that he unhesitatingly gifted her when she sought his recognition. Thus she became his lotus, his Amri, the divine nectar of his dreams, unfurling and blooming beyond his reach in diverse streams. He was whisked away by a patriarch's ambition, and she sought love and solace in a wedding ring, bringing once again the East and West together in her all-embracing being. Her capacity to love and nurture found expression in motherhood, poured generously into three young souls. His gift of poems that told a poet's tale was sent to her by his brother, his Jyotida. She acknowledged that she loved them and knew them by heart, lines she had heard recited and translated for her in Bombay by her poet guest. It was a music she carried with her on her journeys that challenged the distance between the East and West. Her intrepid quest for solace brought her to Edinburgh's tenement retreats, seeking the comfort of her medical student brother. And it was here that her lotus petals folded, muffled by the cold, stony, silent streets, where an exhausted mother and infant bairn were laid to rest, watched over by a discreet Arthur's seat. Alas, with promise and dreams, plucked from the waters where she flourished, is now recovered, restored, and remembered, soaring on the wings of poesy over these tenements, mingling with the sun and clouds of the world's firmament, living as a poet's muse in songs that are a testament to a woman who lived and loved and longed for the sacrament of recognition and fulfillment.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gaurab Chaudhary. By profession, I'm a doctor, but I'm absolutely honored to be part of this beautiful story and this wonderful afternoon. Thank you for inviting me, Hakeda. So my listening to this wonderful story, my interpretation is as if this beautiful bond between Tagore and Anna was woven around music and poetry. So I'm going to pay my humble tribute to both of them by singing a song, a Tagore song, and as if my interpretation is as if they're still on connected on and are on the two sides of the same musical journey. So it's a very well-known Rabindra Sangeet called Dariye Acho Tumi Amar Ganer Opare. So with everyone's permission.
Dariye acho tumi amar pare amar sur guli pae charu ami paine tumare dariye acho tumi amar ganer opare batash bahe Mori mori aar bedhe re khona tori esho esho paar hoye mor ridaye majhare dariye acho tumi amar ganer opare tomar sathe ganer khela surer khela je বেদনাতে বাসি বাজে সকল বেলাজে কবে লিয়ে আমার বাসি বাজাবে গো আপনি আসি আনন্দময় নীরব রাতের নিবিড় আঁধারে দাঁড়িয়ে আছো তুমি আমার গানের পারে আমার সুর গুলি পায় চারণ আমি পাইলে তোমারে দাঁড়িয়ে আছো তুমি আমার গানের পারে
Thank you very much.
So I'm Payal, this is Shubhunil, and this is Dhananjay, lovingly known as DJ. And we're just here, and we're going to celebrate this beautiful occasion. I remember falling in love for the first time. I don't know if all of you do, but I don't think I'll ever forget. And for me, there's this poem. I'd like to read a few lines. I'm sure you have all heard it. It's Tagore's poem. I heard this when I was first 13 years old. I love and hate Tagore at the same time because the way he makes me love. And I think I fall in love over and over again. I'm a hopeless romantic. And I think it's because of him, so I blame Tagore. But this is the poem. I seem to have loved you in numberless forms, numberless times. In life after life, in age after age, forever. My spellbound heart has made and remade the necklace of songs that you take as a gift, wear around your neck in your many forms. In life after life, in age after age, forever. So we all travel on with love in our hearts, love lost, love found, and love lived forever. So here we are today celebrating love. And Nalini and Tagore, I believe, it was their first love for each other. So celebrating first love, I'm going to sing a song. It means, I searched everywhere for you, but you were hiding so deep within my heart and my soul and my body that I couldn't find you anywhere.
Sorry, it's a white.
Like I said, we weren't prepared for this.
Thank you. ले हमारे खलाय तुम्हें मैं आनंद दे ले हमारे खलाय आनंद दाई भूले आनंद दाई भूले छिले कटे थे दिन गोपन रहे गोभीर प्राणे आमार दुख सुखेर गाने गोपन रहे गोभीर प्राणे आमार दुख सुखेर गाने सुर दिए छो तुमि आमि तोमार गान तो गाई आमार याहे माझे নিতে আমি পাইনি আমি পাইনি বাহির পানে চোখ মেলেছি বাহির পানে আমার হৃদয় পানে চাইনি আমার ইয়ার মাঝে ছিল.
My name is Alan Riach. I'm the Professor of Scottish Literature at the University of Glasgow. And about 3 weeks ago, I knew nothing of this story until Vashavi introduced the whole story to me. And I now feel as if there is another star in the constellation. I now feel as if there is another figure, or more than one figure, actually, has come into the company. And it's so wonderful to listen to those songs and heard more about this story and this woman. And Vashavi asked me to read two short love poems that seemed appropriate here. The first by Burns, which I think he said has been translated by Tagore. And the other one, a translation of my own, of a Tagore poem to Nalini, to Anna. So they're both quite short. But it's nice to think that with the music and with the sounds of the words that we've heard, we're now going to put the Scots language into the air as well. And the Burns poem, which I think he said Tagore himself had translated, is called Ye Banks and Braes. It's a song, but I'm not going to sing it. Well, I'll sing it in a different way. Ye banks and braes, O bonny doon, how can ye bloom, sae fresh and fair? How can ye chant, ye little birds, and I sae weary, full care? Thou'll break my heart, thou warbling bird, that wantons through the flowering thorn. Thou minds me, O departed days, departed, never to return. After I roved by bonny doon, to see the rose and woodbine twine, and ilka bird sang o' its love, and fondly, say did I, of mine. We licked some hurt, a poor rose, full sweet upon its thorny tree. And my false lover stole my rose, but he left the thorn with me. And in a sense, it's a tragedy in this story as well. But in a larger sense, as has been said, it's a love story. And that love story is about blossoming, about waking up, about what happens after sleep, after rest, after a long obscurity and darkness, an enlightenment, an enlightening. He these things come together. So the short poem by Tagore, Bashavi mentioned Nalini means lotus. So, and Rabi, as in Rabi Burns, but also in Rabindranath Tagore. Rabi means sun. So the sun opening the lotus flower to the light, and the poet leaving a poem for an unconsummated lover in a kind of poignant gesture of affirmation. I love that, the story that you told us of how this independently minded young woman, slightly older than Tagore, has it that if she leaves her slippers, and the poet, the person who might take them, earns the right to kiss her. But when she wakes up, the slippers are still there. But I like to think of the embellishment of the poem being left by her pillow for when she wakes up. Song to the lotus, Nalini. As the lotus flower so tenderly opens itself to the sun, so tenderly, Nalini, you open your eyes to me. As my song has slipped past the threshold of sleep and lifted its shroud to the day, dawn comes to the world, a new life appears and awakens to new poetry. Each morning I'll come and sing sweetly, smile gently, and hope to awaken you quietly, bright to see. Night is leaving, sunshine arriving, the prize freely given, like this, to your opening eyes. Thank you.
You've all been waiting for us to finally we get to the unveiling. You can see that we are all speaking from the same. So here we go. So we hope this will be here for a long time. It's so solidly stuck on. Thank you, Bas.
Professor Jeffrey, Professor Fraser, Professor Hawkins, thank you very much for this event, and thank you for this beautiful plaque commemorating another notable Indian here in this beautiful city of Edinburgh. You're primed to talk, but do you realize how difficult it is to talk after four professors have spoken? You almost feel like a first-year student entering college, you know, with great trepidation. But yes, I would like to contribute to this event by first reflecting on the name Anapurna. Anapurna in Hindu mythology is from a lady who, on the banks of the river Ganga, used to feed people who came there. And Lord Shiva himself saw this and approached her and blessed her so that the dish on which she serves food would never stop giving. So that is the history or the legend behind the name Anapurna. And isn't it true of Anapurna Littledale as well? Though she died young at 33, she still continues to give. From the testimonies from their families, both in Connecticut and in India, we realize that the impact of her life, though short, has been profound, and it continues to affect us all. I was struck after receiving this write-up from Professor Bashavi Fraser that she died at 33, and then shortly after, the boy also died, which is incredibly tragic. And it just kept me thinking. And then it took me back to the time in India when this would have happened. Women going abroad from India in the 1870s, 80s, or 90s would have been close to impossible. But again, here is a wealthy family from Maharashtra, which is opening up to the tremendous ideas brought in by Scotsmen, by other people, but also fighting its own battle of social and evils that were found at that time in India. And a lot of Scotsmen have contributed to that phase where Indians like Raja Ram Mohan Roy and Tukram and Jyotiba Phule and countless Indians have fought against social ill and triumph. So this is I'm just trying to place where she's come from. But then that from being the achievement of the elite in India at that point in time, very rapidly, I think by the early 1900s, very rapidly spread across all sections of society. And that is what has led to what India is today. I think the seeds were sown back in the 1850s, 40s, could be even with Macaulay's minutes of the 1830s. But subsequently, what we have seen is a flourishing of education and not necessarily in a very European way. India has taken what has come her way through 5,000 or 6,000 years. Every culture has brought in its own, and India has adopted them in her own way. And I think rather than what some would call as brown Englishmen, we've become proud Indians with 75 years of independent history, looking at another 25 and 100 years of independence in another 25 years' time. So this is a tribute to her that after all these years, after 132 years, we continue to remember her. And I thank all the professors here who have put in all the hard work to bring her story out for all of us to know and understand. But I would request you at this stage, I know that you've been doing this for many years now, that please do bring out more stories of this interaction between Scotland and India. I think they need to be told, they need to be read. Our future generations deserve that. And Edinburgh will always remain a big part of India. I'll conclude by offering just two very small examples. When I was young, seeing the title FRCS to doctors of the generation of my grandparents was very common. And I didn't realize what that was. And eventually, when you got a bit more curious, you realize this is, you expand that. And then it was invariably from the Edinburgh University. So we're talking of people in a very remote town in the south of India who have been educated here in Edinburgh. And much later, after I came here, I've had relatives come and go to the Edinburgh College to swathe their parents or their grandparents' names in the records of the medical college. Secondly, we all know that the Scotsmen were the ones who started all the tea estates in India, whether it's in Kalimpong or in the Nilgiris or further south in Munnar. But further south to where I'm from the southern end of India, there are tea estates called Balmoral. And there's another one at Maramalai where two Scotsmen's graves can be found, and the villagers pay an annual tribute on the day of their death because they had transformed those places into habitable places with an economic activity to pursue. So these stories need to be told, and I'm glad that you are doing this so well, and I hope this continues. Good evening.
Thank you. So, Pipers, if you'd like to come back, please do. Thank you all again for coming, and I hope you had a good time. I had some tea.
Thank you.